This week on Wealth Track, part two of our annual exclusive outlook with Wall Street's King of Economists, Ed Hyman, and leading global investor, Matthew McLennan. Their global outlook is next on Consuelo Mack, Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Clearbridge Investments, a Legg Mason company, Thornburg Investment Management, active management, flexible perspective. Ku and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences, and the Fairholme Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. This week we present part two of our exclusive annual outlook with Wall Street's number one economist, Ed Hyman, and global value manager, Matthew McLennan. Now, if you missed part one last week, which was on the state of the U.S. economy and markets, here are Hyman's highlights. A U.S. recession is several years away. We are in the mid-cycle of our economic recovery. Interest rates are still low, and inflation is not evident. A more cautious note was struck by leading global value investor Matthew McLennan, who was worried about peaking corporate profits, still rich market valuations, and extremely high levels of debt, which can slow growth with even small interest rate increases. Ed Hyman is founder, chairman, and head of economic research at Evercore ISI. Hyman has been ranked the number one economist on Wall Street for a record-setting 38 years in Institutional Investor Magazine's survey of professional investors. He is joined by leading global value investor Matthew McLennan, who heads the global value team at First Eagle Investment Management and is portfolio manager of several funds, including the flagship First Eagle Global Fund, which has beaten its World Allocation Fund category in its benchmark on both a total return and risk-adjusted basis since he took over the fund in 2008 from legendary investor Jean-Marie Evillard. This week, our focus goes global. The U.S. led the recovery out of recession in 2009, and it is leading it once again. After a couple of years of synchronized and accelerating global growth, much of the rest of the world is slowing. After outpacing the U.S. in 2016 and 2017, the 19-nation Eurozone is lagging. The European Central Bank recently trimmed its growth forecasts as it attempts to end its massive and unprecedented four-year stimulus program. China, the world's second largest economy, is also slowing as it grapples with the challenges of overbuilding, high levels of bank and government debt, and concerns over trade disputes with the U.S. I began part two of our discussion by asking our guests to give us a new headline to replace the old synchronized global growth theme.
So I haven't used that headline since about March of last year. It was quietly put to bed, and growth is anything but synchronized now, with Europe being slow, China slowing, and the U.S. still doing pretty well. But if you add the three together, the tagline is global slowdown.
Right.
And I would guess that would probably persist in, you know, this into 2019. I think the U.S. is going to slow, you know, about a percentage point from 3 to 2, and I don't really see Europe or China making up for that, so I think it'd be a slower year.
Right, and what would your headline be for the year ahead?
If I look at the international markets, I would say that the big question mark, if you will, is the change in the business model of China, if you will, and what does that mean for the world?
China was one of the countries that you and forces that you mentioned last year, a year ago, that you were very concerned about. So what is going on with China that would cause you more concern?
I think that there's multiple dimensions to this. There is the business cycle dimension. Like the United States, China's also been at a low level of unemployment, so they're at a fairly full level of resource utilization in their economy. Mm-hmm. The second thing is that China was the epicenter of credit creation in the world economy over the last 10 or 15 years. And in the last 5 or 6 years, a lot of that was in the shadow banking sector of China. As they've tried to rein that in, you've seen a collapse in the rate of monetary growth in China. It was growing at about a 15% annualized pace, and it's now down to about an 8% pace. Now, miraculously, the real growth numbers have remained unchanged in that environment. But the
You're saying that it's not possible, right? That the real growth numbers have remained unchanged
it's
credit?
It's a question mark. Secondly, I talked about some of the language that was evolving with respect to the political landscape in China. And in the last year, we've seen the term limit on the presidency removed.
Right.
I mean, this is
a new Mao in the presidency.
This is a geopolitical development that's very meaningful in the context of the last generation. The world's second largest economy, the largest marginal contributor to growth, becomes more overtly autocratic by removing the term limit on the presidency.
Ed, your view on China, and as far as not only the Chinese economy, you know, on its own, but also the impact that what's going on in China, as Matt describes it, and how would you describe it, has on the world economy in the U.S. specifically?
So, first, I think China's pivotal to the world economy.
And because
it's really been the producer of growth in the world economy. Mm-hmm. They're growing 6-7%, and it's pretty big now.
Right.
And so its contribution to global growth has been enormous. We survey 21 companies every week, same company, same person, that do business in China. And that survey has clearly hooked over. Mm-hmm. It's now below 50. Mm-hmm. When they had the hard landing episode, it was down in the mid-30s. Mm-hmm. So it's not there, but it's going the wrong direction. I have a lot of contacts with people that do business in China, like the private equity firms, and they all bring back stories of slowdown. Now, inflation in China is probably less than 2%. Amazing.
That's amazing.
So this low inflation is a global phenomenon because the forces are global in nature, like
competition,
like technology, et cetera. The point at which Matt and I disagree is really on timing. Everything has, I believe, completely. I just think that when we face the deficit problems that are in the system, I think we'll do that when rates are considerably higher than they are now and when you have a inverted yield curve. I also hope, I would say hope, that at that point people will be more optimistic than they are now. I assume that at the end people might get optimistic. And at the moment, it's remarkable how the thought leaders in the financial markets, I'd say most of them, have a pretty negative view, like a recession is in 2019. But I will say this brings us to a very important juncture right now, and that is that China, run as a dictatorship, they're under pressure to not let this trade issue continue to be a problem. So there are two possibilities. One is that China is a long-term player. They're going to just wait until Trump is gone, and 2025, this is World War IV. The other view is that, you know, Trump wants a deal and China would like to have a deal. My feeling is that there's real pressure on both China and the U.S., or let's say, put it in the way you put it, Matt, on Xi and Trump to work something out sooner than later. And that's one view, which I have. The other view is that it's going to be a lot later. And there's many rivers to cross before you get there.
One of the things that constrains them is that they already have a fairly easy fiscal policy. And their ability to ease monetary policy aggressively is constrained by the fact that if they want to do a deal with the Americans on trade, they can't depreciate their currency too aggressively.
We have a team that covers China for us. And they've been focusing on the stimulus measures they're putting into place. When I worry is when inflation is going up and central banks are having to tighten and rates are higher than they are now, that's when I start to get nervous.
If you're saying that's what makes you nervous, then you shouldn't be nervous right now because you're not seeing inflation pick up, you're not seeing interest rates rise. That's substantially.
Yes and no. So first, Consuelo, as you know, I'm always nervous.
Yes, all right.
But it goes back to the same thing as not being late cycle. Late cycle is when central banks are more aggressively tightening And I remember when the Fed tightened in 2007, I was beside myself, because at that point it was very clear that housing was having a major problem.
Right.
And rates were 5 going to 5.25, and it didn't seem right.
It was the wrong thing to do.
It seemed like the wrong thing. I thought it was the wrong thing, and I don't feel that way right now at 2.25. Mm-hmm. And I assume, I think right now people are, like I mentioned, people are assuming that they tighten one more time, 2.5.
That the Fed does.
That the Fed tightens one more time, 2.5, 2.25, and then they pause there, and that doesn't threaten the yield curve too much. If they tighten three times, then they'll go above the bond yield.
But one of the things that's been, I think, a salutary lesson in the international markets is that we've seen cycles in certain big economies that haven't had the normal monetary drivers behind them. And I think of Japan, for example.
Mm-hmm. So you know, talk about Japan.
I mean, basically, you've had an economy with pretty much 0% interest rates for a couple of decades. And they've still had business cycles despite the absence of monetary policy tightening. And so, and in fact, over the last 20 years, that market has gone sideways with volatility while interest rates have been zero. So that is what I call a nominal ice age. And in fact, even in Europe, if you look at the Euro Stoxx 50, it's where it was 20 years ago with volatility. And you have economies within Europe, particularly the northern European economies like Germany with very low interest rates, or Switzerland with very low interest rates. And sometimes in those economies, what's created cycles rather than traditional monetary policy tightening has been attempts to tighten fiscal policy, or windows of uncertainty around sovereign or government creditworthiness, as we saw in the south of Europe, or extreme currency movements one way or the other. And so there are, I guess, other forces that can lead indebted economies into recession, I would say, other than just sort of the real interest rate going up. And we've seen it internationally.
I'll just say, we're not Japan. I tell you, I know the U.S. well. I've been to Japan 50 times. You can believe that. And they had an ice age in nominal GDP. And our nominal GDP is way above where it was in 2008. Mm-hmm. You have Tokyo, which actually is doing well. It's a very prosperous city. But the other cities are just withering on the vine. And the U.S. has, I don't know what, 50 major cities that are doing well. Mm-hmm. And so the U.S. Has really distanced itself, I think, from a Japan model. But there's still the questions you raise about whether or not monetary policy will work again. Mm-hmm. And so I'm watching Japan closely. One thing I'd say, we had a visitor in this morning, and Japan really is opening up immigration.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing.
Because they need workers.
To get out of the ice age.
Yeah. So as far as your view of Japan as an investor, I mean, my understanding is that Europe might be slowing, but Japan is actually doing okay. Is that right?
Well, I would say one of the headwinds for Japan, and it's a similar headwind arguably for Germany going forward, is that these are very manufacturing intensive economies, and manufacturing is being automated. So those jobs are essentially disappearing, and the U.S. economy, as Ed rightly pointed out, is much more service intensive, and Ed talked about some of the new economy services areas, and I think that's been a source of vibrancy for the United States that's perhaps a headwind for Japan. But despite the negatives of Japan from a top-down standpoint, we've managed to find vibrant individual companies in Japan. And I think that's the lesson for us when we look at investing, is that the U.S. does not have a monopoly on good companies. Mm-hmm. It may have a more vibrant economy overall, but it does not have a monopoly on good companies.
Does any country have a monopoly on good companies?
No, they don't. And nor does any one country have a monopoly on currency strength. Uh-huh. That's highly cyclical. And the U.S., by the way, has large current account deficits. The Eurozone and Japan run a current account surplus. Both the Eurozone and the yen are cheap in real terms relative to where they have been over the last 20 years, reflecting the higher levels of interest rates in the United States. If the interest rate comes into question in the United States, those currencies could be strong, mm-hmm. not weak. And so there are things that can go right for investments internationally. And in fact, bottom up, we've seen a little bit more opportunity internationally than we've seen in the United States. If you look at our portfolios, the cash levels have come down a little bit more in our international-only strategies as we've put money to work in this recent sell-off.
And where are you finding opportunities? Just give us an example. I mean, I mentioned that at First Eagle, you look for companies that are resilient. Mm-hmm. You're value investors. So what kinds of opportunities are you seeing overseas?
So like we'd look for in the United States, there's going to be some companies that participate in economic growth and some companies that are more defensive and resilient. And to give you some sense for the range of that, on the one hand, you might have a company in Japan like Fanuc, which is a world leader in factory automation, which you know has been very weak on the back of concerns about China, but it has net cash on the balance sheet. Mm-hmm. And it has a business that's poised to do well over the next decade as robotics grow, servo motor grow, and factory automation equipment deepens its reach. On the other hand, we may have more defensive investments, companies like Groupe Danone, for example, mm-hmm. Which is the world leader in yogurt and bottled water. These are healthy eating categories. This is a company that's invested in its brands and its relevance to consumers. And in both cases, we think you can get mid-single-digit or higher free cash flow yields from these businesses.
And these are long-term holdings.
These are long-term holdings. If you have those kinds of investments with some gold as a potential hedge,
right.
We think that you'll survive the episodic crises that happen in international markets. And these are global businesses as well. So you're not subject to just one currency.
If I may support Matt on this topic, I was on a panel and one of the people on the panel who's one of the greatest investors of our age and a stock bottom-up investor, much like you, he was asked, well, what country do you like the most? And he says, I don't invest in countries. I invest in companies. Exactly what you're saying, which sounds right to me too.
Except in this day and age, with passive investing being so popular, and I'm thinking of we've had a decade of massive flows to index funds, some of them being country funds. I mean, the S&P 500 index funds are basically a lot of it is a bet on the U.S. What's as an economist and looking at countries. What's your advice to investors, Ed?
I would invest in his fund. That's what I would do.
How concerned? Are you concerned about the vulnerability that so many investors now have to index funds, for instance?
Well, the things change.
Yes.
And this has been going on for a long time. There's the move from active to passive, so you have all these funds in passive managers.
Yes.
Which has got to be introducing some sort of unusual behavior mm-hmm. in financial markets. And then you have ETFs, which is another, and they've got
form of passive.
Mm-hmm. Passive investing. And with the way the market has been so volatile this year, I'm beginning to wonder if maybe those things are creating some volatility in the markets. Because of the mechanical way in which mm-hmm. they move money around.
So it's kind of these algorithm trading, this
yes.
is automatic trading, right, and, that happens when
so
they're...
It's possible that you could get some sort of, self-feeding
right.
decline in the market that might be actually happening now. But it's certainly possible in my mind that you get, some sort of cathartic drop
right.
here. And I do worry about the prevalence of passive and ETFs.
I just want to echo one thing that Ed is saying here, and that is that the risk of a lot of money migrating into ETF strategies is by definition, when someone invests in an ETF, they are investing in a manner that is willfully ignoring the price signals of the individual companies underneath,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
or the shift in market position, or capital structure vulnerabilities, or management behavior that may be aggressive. And there are entire indices, for example, that haven't done much over the last couple of decades. And I mentioned a couple to you before, the Euro stocks or the Nikkei. And so just owning an index is not a panacea.
Right.
And in fact, if you look at the history of all stocks listed on the US stock exchange from the 20s onwards, the majority have actually underperformed cash, even though the market as a whole has outperformed handily. It's a minority of companies that tend to deliver the outperformance over time. And so, you know, it's our belief that the role of investing is to thoughtfully curate a business garden, you know, to identify companies that are at the right price, that afford you a margin of safety, that have lower risk characteristics in terms of the stability of their market position, their capital structure, and managements that are kind of growing the business at a sustainable pace. That's very hard to think about if all you're doing is allocating capital between sectors to ETFs.
Right.
Or between countries.
Yeah.
Ed, personally, what are you doing with your, how are you investing personally?
You know, I have a fair amount of cash.
Right. Anyhow, is that just
just because
a normal course of events?
Yeah, life's uncertainty. Yeah, I like to sleep at night.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, you know, I've been really fortunate. I have a number of long-only managers
mm-hmm.
that have done very well, and in part because the market's mm-hmm. gone up.
Right.
And then I have a number of hedge funds. Who've
not done that well. Right, so you're not panicking. You think that the U.S. economy is going to continue.
I may be panicking, but I'm not doing it.
You're not acting on it.
Right.
Anyway, but you're not. I mean, you're positive about the U.S. economy.
Yeah.
And
I mainly like owning assets.
Right.
Whatever. Gold isn't my favorite, but mm-hmm. you're owning something. You know, a Da Vinci or a football team
mm-hmm.
or an equity or Salesforce. Housing, a commercial building.
Right.
But just because they keep printing money, there's a bias to go up in price.
Long-term diversified portfolio, the one investment, thinking again globally, what would it be, Matt?
I think now's a time to at least have some of your money outside the United States
mm-hmm.
dollar. And I think if I can sort of frame it in that way, that a little bit of currency diversification, and we don't try to predict these things in the short term. And who knows, if the Fed keeps raising rates and interest rates stay low elsewhere, the dollar could strengthen. But a number of currencies have been weak against the US dollar, and I'd include gold
mm-hmm.
in that basket as well. So the willingness to just recognize that there are good companies outside the United States, and that the US dollar won't always be strong if the interest rate story comes into question here, is just an element of realism that I think people should focus on right now. And if I think about my own personal investments, the last personal investment I made was to buy a little bit more of our overseas fund.
Mm-hmm. All right, so that to get that more international exposure. And would there be one investment for you from thinking from, a global point of view? We had talked about Salesforce from a domestic point of view.
Well, a company like Salesforce or many other multinationals, be it Exxon or a Weyerhaeuser, they're basically global
mm-hmm.
companies.
Okay.
And Salesforce is one of those.
Right. And is there any asset in particular, Ed, looking around the world that you think is undervalued now?
No. Nothing's really undervalued.
At any rate, thank you both so much again for being on WealthTrack for our New Year Outlook. Ed Hyman and Matt McLennan, thanks so much.
Thank you.
One of my perennial New Year's resolutions is to read more books that are inspiring and not necessarily work-related. I am a huge Winston Churchill fan, as were my parents. At the age of 19, my dad was an army private in the Battle of the Bulge, where he was captured, became a German POW, and for months was reported missing in action. Churchill was a hero in our home. From an early age, I remember listening to recordings of Churchill's most famous speeches and standing taller because of them. This week's Action Point is to read two excellent but lesser-known books about the unimaginable challenges Churchill faced upon becoming Prime Minister in 1940. The first is 5 Days in London, May 1940, by eminent historian John Lucas. It is about the five crucial days, May 24th to 28th, that literally could have changed the world. Churchill was fighting powerful enemies within Britain who still wanted a negotiated peace, and Hitler, whose armies had blitzkrieged through Europe and had British soldiers cornered in France. We all know how it ended, but I had no idea how perilous Churchill's and Western civilization's fates really were. The other is Citizens of London, the Americans Who Stood with Britain in Its Darkest, Finest Hour, by Lynn Olson. There were three Americans, CBS correspondent Edward R. Murrow, millionaire Avril Harriman, and U.S. Ambassador John Gilbert Winant, who became part of Churchill's inner circle and were instrumental in finally persuading a reluctant FDR to back Britain. Both books are fascinating, riveting, and inspiring. They make great gifts for loved ones and yourself. Next week, we move on to China for an exclusive interview with pioneering Asia investor Mark Headley, now chairman of the board of his old firm, Matthews Asia. In the meantime, in our extra feature, Ed Hyman and Matt McLennan will share their current favorite books with us, which we will have for you on WealthTrack.com. We welcome your comments and suggestions, so please reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching. Have a lovely weekend, a wonderful Christmas holiday, and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Clearbridge Investments, a Legg Mason company, Thornburg Investment Management, active management, flexible perspective, Ku and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences, and the Fairholme Foundation.